Okay.
Wrong button, sorry.
And it's okay. And so it speaks about when someone is ready to perish. I see your hand, Pastor. Deaconess, I know you're going to be reading next, but can you please grab, look up and get the word perish and just give us a little more insight on that word perish? Because I want everybody to be like clear, you know, at when it's, you know, when you give someone a strong drink, you know, give strong drink unto him that is ready to perish. And then wine unto those that are of heavy heart. So while she's getting that, yes, Pastor.
Okay, perish. This literally means they're dying. They're dying.
You're right.
Mm-hmm. They're in their last days. They either have a strong disease or a disease that's killing them. It's like hospice today. Mm-hmm. We don't give them strong drink. We give them morphine. Strong, because what alcohol does, it numbs you. It's an anesthetic. Mm-hmm. That's why people can go about drunk and not know what's going on, you know, walking around dead. And so it makes them sleep. It knocks them out until they die. So what we do today, that's why I didn't say give them wine. It said give them strong drink, something that absolutely numbs the pain, just knock them out until they die. That's what it means. So today we don't give them strong drink. We give them strong morphine. All right.
And thank you so much for that, Pastor, because by you saying that, it actually helps us to be, well, for me, it helps me to be able to clearly understand and envision, you know, and the breaking and the rightliness of the rightly dividing God's word. Because back then, they didn't have the morphine. They didn't have certain things. And we're talking about the Old Testament. Just as you were speaking about the wine back then, now the wine is, it goes through a whole nother process, and it's for really a whole nother purpose. It's more for the social drinking and everything. Then, as we learned last week, the water was really contaminated. They didn't have the filter systems that we have now. So that's why they drink the wine. So like you, and that perish, deal with that word perish, and it was just like when a person is just ready to just die. And they spoke about in like even in war, you know, if you can't, just that numbing effect. And so for you to give that comparison of the morphine now, it actually makes it clearer for understanding. So Deaconess, did you have something on that perish?
Yeah, it just says to suffer, complete ruin or destruction, die, come to an end. So just other words, so just, you know, the suffering of death.
Right. Amen. The suffering of death. And that's when you give them strong. Did it say anything about, well, suffering? That's that word when I was saying it said something about horrible or something. And that's it. That word suffering, that's enough.
Yeah.
So that's when you give somebody strong drink. And just as Pastor would share with us now they give them morphine until just to subside that suffering and that pain until eventually they go on and pass away. And then, you know, people with a heavy heart, you know, you give them wine, people of a heavy heart, you know, and wine unto those that be of a heavy heart to like lighten the burdens again, it releases, we're speaking about releasing the anxiety and the burden. That's what we're studying now. And so just, you know, that wine for somebody that's heavy and hard and, you know, needs to just have some type of break from the anxiety or, you know, just the burden. And again, not speaking about trying to escape or forget, because when you're doing that, then you're trying to just, you have that purpose to just drink until you can't feel it no more, or until you think it's gone, until you wake up and then it's still there. So thank you so much, Pastor and Deaconess. And Deaconess, you have friends and social drinking.
Be not among wine bibbers, among riotous eaters of flesh, for the drunkard and the glutton shall come to poverty, and drowsiness shall clothe a man with rags.
So that speaking, that right there is just a warning to, not just a warning, is a warning about be not among wine bibbers, because in God's word also, it teaches us that be not deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. So you don't want to, if you know somebody that, you know, drinks a lot, or, you know, just does things that you don't do or that you don't want to begin to do, then, you know, be not among them. Be not among the wine bibber or the riotous eaters of flesh. Which one that got me was, for the drunkard and the glutton shall come to poverty. So because after so long, you're not going to be able to sustain once you become, you know, dependent upon the alcohol. You're not going to be able to, it's going to interfere with your ability to do things to sustain yourself. It's going to interfere with your ability to go to work. It's going to interfere with your ability to take care of yourself. And so what is the end result of that? Is poverty. Remember when we read earlier about when people were drinking to escape the poverty. So when you overindulge and this begins to consume you, then that will leave you poverty stricken. And drowsiness shall clothe a man with rags. You know, and people, because when you think about it, when you see someone that has been drinking and drinking and drinking, you see how they sometimes have that drowsy look. They just be, you know, their eyes are low, you know, they're heavy and they're drowsy. So that's what, you know, that's it for our reasons for drinking. You know, you don't want to, you know, social drinking, you know, God tells us if people are wine bibbers to just come from amongst them. You know, you have enough problems on your own if you're going to be, you know, but we have to watch the company that we keep, you know, because people influence our lives, whether we realize it or not. People who we allow and who we are among, they can influence our life. So those are some of the reasons, and those are the reasons that we covered for tonight. Is there any questions or comments before we begin to go into the effects of wine? Is there any comments or questions or concerns or anything that anyone would like to share about one of the reasons, all of the reasons, any of the reasons? We're open to do so right now. Yes, Pastor.
Oh, there go me again. Okay. Well, I looked up the warning. The warning is Alcoholic Beverage Labeling Act in 1988. And it says, according to the Surgeon General, women should not drink alcoholic beverages during pregnancy because of the risk of birth defects. That's number one. Two, Consumption of alcoholic beverages impairs your ability to drive a car or operate machinery and may cause health problems. So that's on every alcoholic beverage. And here's the law that says the health warning statement must appear on all alcoholic beverages for sale or distribution in the United States containing not less than 0.5% alcohol. So if it contains over 0.5%, which they all do, it has to have that label on it. So then I looked up the content of alcohol in different drinks. So 12 ounces of beer has 5%. So that's 10 times what is considered. 5 ounces of wine has 12%. We're talking about percent of alcohol. 1.5 ounces of strong drink, they call it distilled spirit, is 40%, or almost straight alcohol. And so all of them have alcohol. So if 12 ounces, or excuse me, if 5 ounces of wine has 12% of alcohol, there's a warning on it. There's a warning on everything. And so if you drink, so let's see, 5 ounces of wine has 12% alcohol, but you drink 10 ounces, now you got 24%. So 4 ounces, 20 ounces of alcohol of a wine is the same as strong drink, according to the content of alcohol in these beverages today, which is different from back in the day. So that's why if you're going to drink wine, just drink a little. Because if you keep drinking and drinking and drinking, it's just the same as drinking strong drink. So there is a warning, a Surgeon General warning on all alcohol beverages. And so I think I sent that to you. I sent it to your phone so you could have it.
I seen something come across. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So you can look at it later. All right.
Okay.
Praise God.
All
So we
right.
have to be in the know.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. And yes, Sister Gloria, I see your hand.
I was going to say, if you see my eyes and they're red and droopy looking, it's not from wine. My eyes didn't do this until after the cataract surgery. And they do feel heavy.
Yeah,
They do
that's
feel heavy. And I think the lens they put in your eyes are heavier than your normal born with lens. So I just want you to know that if you see me, I haven't been drinking.
Amen.
No,
And I have
no,
naturally
no.
dark eyes too. It's something to do with our pigment. So just because we
But
got
you
red eyes, don't mean
know
we've been drinking
what?
and smoking.
Oh no. Because when that happens, it also says shall be clothed, and drowsiness shall clothe a man with rags. So you can see it. So we wouldn't know. No, absolutely not, Sister Gloria. No. She said, "Don't if my eyes be red." No, this is a whole different kind of drowsiness. This don't even. This not even from being tired after you don't work so long, and no, this is a whole nother. Thank you, Pastor. I got another one from you. Thank you. Thank you both for sharing so much. Anyone else before we move on to the effects of wine? Okay. So we've gone over some of the reasons. Now we'll discuss a little bit about the effects. So the first effect is it, well, let's do Proverbs 20, the effects of wine, 23 and 32. Oh. There it is right there. That's the effect they got that is at the last, it biteth like a serpent and stingeth like an adder. And as our pastor
share with us, the adder is a poisonous snake. She looked that up. She looked that word, that adder up, and it is a poisonous snake. So it stingeth like an adder. And so then we're going to do 23 and 29. So I'm going to do, who just read? Deaconess. So now we're with Sister Diana. So Sister Diana, we're going to have you do 23 and 29. And then Sister Gloria will have you come down and do B. And we'll discuss, I think we'll do A, B, and C. And then Sister Shalanda, you 23 and 29. They all seem to have 23 and 29. So let's see what 23 and 29, because this seems to cover a lot. But on Sister Gloria, you also have 20 and 1. So let's look at some of this, how it produces woes and sorrows for the one who drinks and for his family. Oh my. Okay. So Sister Diana, you have 23 and 29.
23 and 29. Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has strife? Who has complaints? Who has needless bruises? Who has bloodshot eyes?
So, who hath woes and who hath sorrow? Who hath contentions? Who hath babbling? Who hath wounds without cause? And who hath redness of eyes? So, that's about why, how the wine produces these sorrows in you. And for, I see your hand, Pastor, and you on.
Yes, she ma'am. Really should read 30. I don't know why they didn't put 30 in there, because it goes right along. So, but really, and I look down at the whole outline, I don't see 30 anywhere on here, but we must add 30 to that.
Okay.
Okay.
So that's you, Sister Diana.
Those who linger over wine, who go to sample bowls of mixed wine.
Okay. And that does make a lot. Thank you so much, Pastor. And Deaconess, I see your hand. And Sister Gloria, I see your hand as well.
I forgot to take mine down. I forgot to take it.
Okay, Deaconess, yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to read it out to Amplify.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
It 29 says, and 30, please.
Yes. Who has woes? Who has sorrows? Who has strife? Who has complaining? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness and dimness of the eyes? Those who tarry long at the wine. Those who go seek and try mixed wine. That's it.
Those who tarry. Amen. But that completes it. Because why? You have, it's those who tarry long at the wine. And thank you so much, Pastor, for pointing that out. Because that brings it together as to why you have the redness of the eyes, why you have the woes. Why? Because you tarry long. And for those that don't know what tarry mean, that mean like you stay long. You stay long with the wine. You spend a lot of time with the wine. You linger with the wine. You take up time with the wine. That is why the wine at the end, it brings woes. brings the sorrows. It brings the complaining. And you have wounds without a cause. Because have you ever seen somebody who done tarried long or done got... When you're drunk, you fall, you stumble, your balance is off, you're staggering all over the place, and you get wounds, then you don't even know where they came from. You're all beat up, you badgered up, and you don't even know where they've come from. And then it speaks about not only does it have that effect and that woe and that sorrow for you, but it also, your family does not want to see you in that condition. You know, when whoever it is, if it's your, it don't matter. If you love them, whatever the relationship is to the person who you are seeing just being destroyed by this alcohol, you're sorry. You can't help but to, you know, you cry, you know, your heart goes out, you know, you just, it's saddening, you know, and you're worried, and it has a real hard effect on people who have to look at people who they love just destroy themselves over alcohol. So it is true. It's not just for the one who drinks, but it's also the one whose family it is. It's all for, and it don't even have to be a blood family. It could be your friend. It could be someone who, an acquaintance. But you to just watch someone utterly just be destroyed, that's hard. That's very, you know, hard on your heart, and nobody wants to see that. Even when you have the compassion of Christ, even when you see people who you don't even know, homeless people or people who are just so messed up, it tears at your heart because you actually don't want that for that person. You actually, you know, wish it was different for that person. It's hard to witness any kind of way, no matter if you know the person or not. Mm-hmm. So it is, it produces woe and sorrow for people who are actually drinking, and for the families, and for just strangers who may see the evidence. Yes, Pastor.
Oh yeah, go again. And the key word is without cause. You're beat up. You got these contentions, sorrows, babblings, wounds, redness of eyes. Nobody did it to you but yourself. That's why it says without cause, for no reason. Nobody came over there and beat you up and beat you down. You wounded yourself. You wounded yourself by tarrying too long at the wine. You need to get that one glass and go about your business. Amen. And if you can't handle a glass, leave it all alone, all together. Because it's you just, and you, and that's what it does. It, like you said, Sister Jeanette, that compassion, they're hurting their own self. But they're deceived. And so after it gets you, when it's stinging, they can't see it until they're dead. I've seen, see that red, that orange hand up there? I don't think they can see that on regular YouTube when it records over, but we can see it. See that yellow hand? Mm-hmm. I've taken care of patients that color. That color, their eyes, their skin, everything destroyed their liver. It's just terrible, you know, and without a cause. That means for no reason. Nobody beat you up. Nobody did it to you. You did it to your own self. So somebody last week said, I think it was Deacon that said, we enter the prevention business. We try to, through this word, the Holy Spirit is trying to prevent you from going there. Amen. Trying to prevent you from going there. And I always say, a 1 ounce of prevention is worth 10,000 pounds of intervention and cure. Amen. Because some of it you can't cure. It causes death. And it's sad. It's sad. And that's why that warning on all those alcoholic beverages. Too long with the wine. If you drink one glass, it only has a certain percent. But if you drink four, that's the same as strong drink. But anyway, we're getting knowledge. So pray.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. And that 30, definitely, that they tarry just too long. So it produces contention. We kind of went over that. And wine releases one's inhibitions, thinking he now possesses greater strength, he becomes boisterous and obnoxious. And so, Sister Gloria, you can read, and I think it's good for us to read 29, 23, 29, and 30 all three times. And then you also have 20 and 1 so that we can just get it. Mm-hmm.
Proverbs 20 and 1, wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise.
Amen. And so 29 and 30 again is who hath the woe? Who hath woe? Who hath sorrow? Who hath contentions? Who hath babblings? Who hath wounds without cause? Who hath redness of eyes? They that tarry long at the wine, they that go and seek mixed wine. And 21 is telling you, wine is a mocker, and strong drink is raging. And whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. And Pastor, I know last week you gave us that mocker, but I can't call it to memory. Can you give us that word mocker so we can have clear understanding of just exactly what the wine that mocker?
Mocker is just a deception. It's a mocker. It's like, okay, come on. It's sparkling. Come on, drink. Even friends, come on, you can drink. You can have a little bit. That's social. You can have a little bit. And before you know it, you're deceived. You're an alcoholic. So you have to be careful with those things. And that's what mockery. Wine is a mocker. It's a deceiver. It will get you just like the harlot. You know, she's trying to lure you in, but she don't love you. She ain't got no love for you. She wants your money. Mm-hmm. You know, but she got no love for you. The devil sent her to destroy you. And that's pretty much what mocking is.
Amen. Thank you so much. And then you have the physical problems. And that physical problem, let me see. I believe Sister Shalonda, you had that one as far as the physical problems. So 23 and 29, it tells a lot. It tells about the woes. It does tell about how it produces contention. And now it speak about the physical problem. So Sister Shalonda, if you will finish us up with that 23, 29 through 30, and then we'll speak about the physical problems.
Okay, Proverbs 23. 29 and 30. He who hath woe, who hath sorrow, who hath contention, who hath babbling, who hath wounds without cause, who hath redness of eyes. They that tarry long at the wine, they that go seek mixed wine.
Amen. So then we're speaking about the physical problems now. And just like as Pastor was speaking about the different conditions that the wine or, you know, that causes over time, you know, it's more of a long term and long range problem, you know. And again, just as we were speaking about how, you know, when someone is drunk and they fall, they
they knock themselves, they hit something, they knock themselves, you know, they fall, they stagger and they fall. And not only that, but they're impaired. And people have lost their lives. That's why it tells you don't operate heavy machinery, because your judgment is impaired. You know, people that get behind the wheel, you know, and they're, you know, and they're intoxicated. Their judgment is impaired, and it causes physical problems, not only to themselves, but it can cause, it can have a deadly effect. So, you know, when you tarry to, and it's about, and the reason why it becomes so serious is in 30, because you tarry too long with it. You drunk it too long. You spent too much time with it. You consumed too much of it. You tarried with it and you stayed with it. And so then it just produces physical problems and sorrows, you know, just being bitter, and you know, you become contentious and, you know, irritated with people and, you know, mad, and, you know, and it causes violence. It causes all kinds of physical problems. Not only about what it can do to you, but what it can also cause from you. You know, when people are there, they're not aware. We spoke about how people become obnoxious and boisterous, that, you know, they get that, you know, what I would call it, I ain't gonna say it, but it makes them, they got strength that they really don't have. Then they go to swing, they get beat. It's just no. Deaconess, I seen your hand.
I was just gonna let you keep on speaking, but I just wanted to add, though, you know, part of it is that it impairs your reasoning. You know, your reasoning and your emotions are exaggerated, whether it be negative or positive. You know, so all of it is just basically, you know, we have to have a sober mind, because we have to reason with the Lord. We have to reason with life. So that's just my input. That's it.
Amen. Amen. And that's good input. Reason with life. And it does affect your ability to reason.
Amen.
It affects your judgment. You know, and we do. I like that reason. We have to reason with the Lord, and we do have to reason with life. Amen. Yes, Sister Smart, I see your hand.
I just wanted to say, out of the contemporary book, English version, the way it reads in 29, I just wanted to read it because it seems real simple. It says, who is always in trouble? Who argues and fight, who cuts, who has cuts and bruises, whose eyes are red. And 30 reads, everyone who stays up late having just one more drink.
Wow. Everyone who stays up late just having one more drink. Oh, we cuts and bruises, always in trouble. Oh, thank you for sharing that translation with us. Who is it? The ones who stay up late having just one more drink. Oh my. That was a very good translation. Thank you so much, Sister Smart, for sharing that with us. So at this time, is there anyone that has anything they want to share about the lesson so far? If not, we're gonna do, maybe I think we can do D. But does anybody have anything they want to share about the lesson? Any insight, input?
concerns, questions? Okay. So let me see. Deaconess, I think it's to you to read. Sister Shalanda read. And Deaconess, did you read?
No, I haven't read.
Oh, okay. Okay. So what we're going to do is have you read 23 and 33. And this speaks about hallucinations. And how this is all, we're still speaking about the effects of wine. It speaks about hallucinations and loses touch with reality, becoming prey to fantasies and illusions. So, Deaconess, if you will read 23 and 33.
Thy eyes shall behold strange women, and thy heart shall utter perverse things.
Thine eyes shall behold strange women, and thine heart shall utter perverse things. So that is speaking about how your eyes, you're going to behold, Sister Smart, I knew she was going to read it out of her translation. I see your hand, Sister Smart. I was going to call on you to read it in out of your translation, but I see Pastor's hand up too. So let's do Pastor, and then we'll let you read it from your translation. Yes, Pastor.
Amen, amen. Yeah, we need that translation. Yeah. Also write this scripture down in your book where you have Isaiah 44:20. This is talking about that deceived heart. In our study material, it's comparing it to that woman, the seductress that deceives you. But look
okay,
at
so
Isaiah.
Are you saying write it by a certain question, Pastor, or yeah, just because I have the other ones on top of it?
Right next to hallucinations.
Okay, okay. And that's Isaiah what?
44 and 20, where it says, loses touch with reality, becoming prey to fantasies and illusions. Literally.
Okay.
Amen. So it says, he feedeth on ashes. A deceived heart has turned him aside, that he cannot deliver himself, nor say, is this not a lie in my right hand? This thing in your right hand that you're pouring your enemy down in you, it's got you confused, deceived. So it deceives your heart. You become confused. And so that scripture right there, and they literally have hallucinations. They literally are confused. It just a mess. This is the physical part. And there's of course the spiritual connotation, because the devil wants you to be out of your mind. Like Deaconess said, be sober. You know, we're in a warfare. We have to stay.
Yes.
So we can't entangle ourselves in this mess. So we have to stay sober, because we got an enemy out there that's going to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. And he uses alcohol to do that. So, but this is another scripture for that deceived heart. Isaiah 44 and 20. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor. And yes, Sister Smart, Sister Smart, I see your hand.
Okay, out of the contemporary version of that last scripture of Proverbs 29. Oh, no, that's
no, 23.
23
and 33.
Okay, yes, there it is. 23 and 33 reads, you will see weird things, and your mind will play tricks on you. That's what mine reads. Mm. You will see weird things, and your mind will play tricks on you. That's Proverbs 23 and 33,
it's
from
true.
The contemporary version.
Wow. Mm-hmm. You will see strange things. You will see, read it again, Sister Smart. Weird. Okay, weird.
Says, you would see weird things and your eyes will play tricks on you.
And in King James, it reads, thine eyes shall behold strange women, and thine heart shall utter perverse things. You know, so I see your hand, Pastor, and it's, you know, like with Sister Smart's Bible translation, it speaks about your eyes will see weird things. And weird things, and what else, Sister Smart?
And your eyes will play tricks on you.
And play tricks on you. There you
your
go.
Your eyes will and play tricks on you.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, and when you think about that, about when you see something weird and your eyes will, under the influence, your eyes can play tricks on you. Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry, Sister Jeanette. I think I read that wrong. It's say you will see weird things and your mind
okay.
will play tricks on you. Okay.
Your mind will play tricks on you. That's where the fantasies, you'll be prey to fantasies because your mind is playing tricks on you. So that's how come you can fall prey to those fantasies and illusions, you know, because they have some things that actually really cause real serious hallucination. You know, hallucination is a very, very real state of mind. Your mind can, and again, your mind, that's when your mind plays tricks on you. You're actually thinking you're seeing something that is not real. You know, just like that strange woman, you know, it speaks about thy eyes shall behold strange women. You know, strange women, that, I mean, when you think, Lord, we don't have to really, really go into that scripture. I that scripture, because it speaks, it's so real and it's so important because it can actually like happen. It happens all the time where people, their mind actually plays tricks on them. And so if that is an effect of wine, you might, you know, you don't think about wine having that type of effect. You really do not. You start thinking about, you know, other drugs, you know, like illicit drugs and stuff, having those, because some people have done something one time and never been the same. Their mind was just gone from that point. So it's just, I don't know, that just really, it is just that scripture, especially when you broke it down about, you know, your mind playing tricks on you, you'll see weird things and your mind will play tricks on you. And it's so different. It's such a different read from the King James, where it says, thine eyes shall behold strange women and thine heart shall utter perverse things. So it's, that seems like a real big difference in translation. Pastor, what's your input?
Well, it right here says loses touch with reality. Mm-hmm. Now, with the strange woman, let me stop this. With the strange woman, she's just deceiving your mind. But with the alcohol, I've been tearing up too long at it, it absolutely destroys your brain cells. That's why it says this is under physical problems. It destroys your brain cells. It is a cause. One of the dementias is called alcoholic dementia. It gives brain, literal physical brain damage. So you have people, they shake, they stuff. Oh, that's from alcohol. It's toxic. Mm-hmm. It's stinging like an adder. And it's all because you tear it too long. This is something you can't play with. If you're going to drink a drink with your dinner, let it be. Drink it with your dinner a couple of times a week. But you just, like I said, that version that Sister Sharon had, like I said, we're going to have to use that. But it causes, a hallucination is from a literal physical brain damage. And they're using, the King James is using the deceptive woman, because you still think perversely. It's not no brain damage. That's just your mind.
Yes. You know? Okay. It does, okay.
But it does the same thing. That's what that is.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much, because that just wasn't connected for me. Like, this is the strange woman and the weird thing and the, you know, plant on your mind. So again, I thank you so much, Pastor, for that clarity. So I think we're going to end at 7:29, and we will pick up next week on where it dulls the sense. So thank you, everyone, so much for participating in our Wednesday night Bible study. And I am going to give it over to the hands of our pastor at this time. Thank you, Pastor. And thank you, everyone.
Okay. Thank you, Sister Jeanette.
Praise God. I have to tell y'all that we've looked at the mind element. We looked at the physical element and then that spiritual element. When King James is talking about that woman, the mind, talking about witchcraft. Witchcraft. Anything that can get in your mind, if it's not a physical thing, well, that's witchcraft too, and sorcery. But it's because you could have a person, and since that's speaking of young men, young gullible men, these women, these seductresses can get so into their mind, you think they're crazy. Everybody can see it but them. And so it is witchcraft. We can never forget the spiritual aspect. Amen. And so that's why you don't want to open the door to the devil. You don't want to give any place to the devil. When we come next week, I'm going to take you into a scripture that tells you how you only want to go so far with this thing. You got to have power over it so it doesn't have power over you. Because wine, there's nothing in itself wrong with wine, but it's got the power to addict you. And so we looked at that mind element, hallucinations, and we looked at the physical part, but there's that spiritual part, because anybody can tell you, male or female, if you ever been seduced, you is crazy in the mind. Everybody can see that there's something wrong with that person but you. You just, it's foolish, and you're really literally under a spell of witchcraft. And so that's what I had to bring out, that we can never forget that the spiritual aspect. It's a three-part warfare: spirit, soul, and body. And so that's all I want to say to that. And with that, instead of reading a benediction stuff, I want to go out on that song. I'm a soldier. Don't ever forget you're a soldier. You're a soldier. Soldiers don't be getting drunk. Soldiers got to stay sober. Amen. So I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord, and we are fighting a literal warfare. So we can't give ourselves over. So the Bible says, be sober and be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is walking about like a lion, seeking whom he may devour. And he uses alcohol to do that. And again, you can have a little glass of alcohol, but if you tear it too long, You got sorrows and woes and stuff for no reason. You find yourself depending on that when you're supposed to depend on God. So this is a wonderful one. We thank you, Sister Jeanette, and thank you all for your participation. But remember, this is preventative. You see people out there picking in the air and hallucinating. That's a lot of times they have some drugs, but a lot of times that's alcohol. A deaconess will tell you, alcoholic dementia. We see them all the time. They don't think like other people. They have brain damage. Their cells in their brains have been damaged from carrying. So this is very serious. And we just pray for them. But if no one else has anything to say, I'd like to go on that song. We're in the army of the Lord. And don't ever forget it. Spirit, soul, and body. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Sister Jeanette. God bless.
Amen. Right. Thank you, Lord.
Okay, I'm gonna put your song on the record. I hope it, if they kick it off, it's just too bad. Okay, here we go.
Our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It's against the powers of this dark world. Therefore, put on the full armor of God. Stand your ground.
I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. I'm a soldier in the
stand
army.
Your ground.
I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. I'm a soldier in the army.
I got my war clothes on
in the army of the Lord.
I got my war clothes on.
Amen. Stand your ground and give no place to the devil. Love y'all. God bless you. See some of you.
All right. Love y'all.
God bless you.
Good lesson.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.
Love y'all.